My name is Caroline Sinders, and I'm going to give a talk on designing consent in social networks. Though this feels way more accurate for who I am. And the title of this may be a bit of a misnomer, because at first I really want to get into the way that language is constructed in digital spaces, but particularly by AI and chat robots. So I study online fandoms, communities, internet culture, and online harassment. And my job sometimes sounds like this. I work at IBM Watson in conversational analytics with chat robots as a user researcher. Please don't tweet that. but I believe that design can facilitate, guide, and disseminate language. And I believe a lot of that just not because I actually do work with robots, but I grew up in New Orleans, Louisiana, and Louisiana has this dying but spoken language called Cajun. It's Cajun French and it's not written, and I grew up listening to it all around me. And as technology and as our world became more interconnected and technology sort of began to overtake and really create these new beautiful spaces in our lives, Cajun started to be spoken less and less, and now it's almost dead language. So I have this obsession with the way language exists and evolves in spaces, especially as technology is brought into that space. I spend a lot of time looking at a lot of different ways that we structure language online and the way that language is structured for AI. I've done a lot of audits, I've read a lot of white papers, and I've probably spent way too much time with Siri. So this is something I find to be the most fascinating. Do any of you remember going through grammar school and having to diagram a sentence? So this is a way that a computer starts to understand and diagram the way that we speak to it. So remind me to feed the baby tomorrow at 7 a.m. So feed the baby is the task. The intent is an agenda. And then tomorrow is the time. So the way that language gets broken down with AI is through all these different things. It's intents, it's actors, dialogue, chit-chat, and all these words actually get redefined from company to company. I can't really speak the way that my company defines it, but one of the things I find most fascinating is intent. What is the purpose of the sentence? And how do we create a context in a digital space for that? So one of the ways that happens is someone like myself has to go through and start creating knowledge branches and trees for conversation. So the human becomes the curator for the AI, and it starts to structure and base the way the sentence would unfold and the way that like a corpus of data can be restructured. And I find this to be so incredibly fascinating because it's this intersection of human intervention and algorithm and really a human component with chat robots. So these are some things to consider when, I guess, if you were to ever create an AI, would be disambiguation or intent. So if you ever have an AI ask you, what do you mean, or can you clarify, there's a break in what the AI is trying to structure within context. So everything you write or say to an AI is context. Hi, my name is Caroline. Caroline is pulled out as the actor. Name is what's defining me as that. Say, I have a problem with rain. Okay, am I calling an insurance company? Am I calling like the 311? All these things start to get built together. So if it's 311 and I say I have a problem with rain, oh great, can you clarify? Okay, I have a problem with rain in my apartment. And this starts to build out this greater context as to what the AI is trying to help and look at, trying to help you and look for. So it starts to create a knowledge tree of where to siphon and silo you into an actionable answer. So that's a lot of what I spend my time doing at my job. And one thing I've noticed is there's all these really, really specific trends that are coming out, especially around these other companies that I've done audits on. So it's, you hear all these words over and over again, Internet of Things, wearable devices, chat activated games, voice recognition, speech to text, and robotics. And I find all this really fascinating because it's all around language and the way that human users will interact with these objects. What happens if a game does start and it can acknowledge your voice? What if it can separate your voice from someone else's voice? What happens when voice is translated to text? What is context within this digital space? What is a word or a sentence if it's not actually understood, but it's being parsed and diagrammed and pulled apart? Do we have context in language in digital spaces? And the one thing I've learned from this, and sorry, it's really hard to read, is it says language is data, language is a system. So this is sort of the crux of this argument I've been formulating around, is there consent in digital spaces, particularly in social media? So I hope all of my work has sort of presented this as a foundational argument as language is data and language lacks context. We in this room give language context. We define what sentences mean and what they are. And the system cannot do that. And an AI kind of can't either. We can teach emotion and say this is what love is and define it and provide synonyms and then provide synonyms to those synonyms, but it's not actually understood. We provide that to the system itself. So because I spend so much time creating systems around languages and creating systems specifically around conversations, I've gotten into this way of thinking of systems design and how do systems affect behavior. Now, I would argue that it affects behavior immensely, but that's also because I spend, you know, 40 hours a week in knowledge trees, sitting in the weeds trying to get an AI to speak. But I really believe that systems affect behavior in the way that they outline the way of which we interact. So if there's any sort of pushback in a system, Siri asking, can you clarify? Or, have any of you ever said anything really dirty to Siri? Or like a little aggressive, maybe like a curse word or two? There's a little bit of pushback, and that's the system itself recognizing those specific words and actually then trying to guide what is considered behavior in a specific way. And that's what the system, and that's what like engineers and user researchers and designers have started to create. This is the way that we want people to interact with the system. And that's feedback, and that's pushback, right? So if that's like the barriers in a highway, if you get a little too close to it, right? Like that's the system pushing back and saying like, no, this isn't the behavior we want. And that shapes behavior, and that moves behavior in a specific way, especially when there is feedback, and users need feedback in these systems. So I strongly believe that systems affect behavior and they lead behavior and they guide behavior. So this is sort of a breakdown on systems design. So user interface design is concerned with how users add information to the system and how the system presents information back to them. And I think UI is one of the most important elements in a system, especially in social networks, but in any software, the UI points for a user are beyond important. They help guide action. They help provide where to go when. They provide context, and context is key. Data design, number two, is concerned with how data is represented and stored within the system. And finally, there's process design, and that's concerned with how data moves through the system and where it's validated, secured, and transformed, and where it flows to. And all these are incredibly important in system design. The beginning, like the top layer, is what the user sees, and what they don't see is the data design or the process, but those are almost as important as the UI. Does the UI represent accurately how data is transformed or moved, or the way the process is defined? How many of you have thought about pulling back the hood, so to speak, of Twitter? What do you think you would see? Do you think it would match up with the way our timeline is and the way that we interact with our tweets on a daily basis? Or what about Facebook? So when I look at Facebook and Twitter, I see not just this like timeline of beginning to end, but I think about all these different moving asynchronous parts that are bringing data from different points to different places. In a way, like if I could peel the layer back, I think that that's what I would see. I would see algorithms and clouds based on top of each other, interacting at different places and pulling in different kinds of information based off the context that I've provided to the system. Me, Caroline, everything I've fed this system, everything I've shaped it, and the way that I've started to define when I post and how I post and who I interact with. So I'm sure I'm beating you over the head with this, but I really believe everything is a system. And I see digital language as a specific part of this system. But it's even in a bigger system of itself, especially with the way AIs understand language. Digital cultural and social networks is a digital system with digital cultural rules and regulations led, partitioned, and defined by infrastructural design and the greater network of itself. So if you think a lot about privacy checkpoints or code of conducts or what you can see when or blocking, you're starting to define that system. But users within the system itself give a greater cultural context to what these mean. That's why Reddit is a lot different than Twitter. And that's why rules implemented in Reddit often will have a greater backlash than in Twitter. The users on that base are providing the cultural context as to what Reddit means to them at that time. So it's this fantastic tension I find between the creators of the system trying to define what the system is, and then the people on the system redefining what it is to their needs and the way they've actually used it. So in architecture, there's sort of this joke where it's like form, well, it's like form over function. So when a place gets built, you can see the way that they've defined people to go to like on pathways, and then you'll see the pathways people create themselves. So it's usually this worn out area in the grass. So you'll see like the concrete walkway, and then you'll see the way people actually go. And that's sort of this perfect encapsulation of what this tension is. You can define as a creator the way a system is laid out and what you hope for, but if there's no pushback or guidance for a user, users will add their own meaning to that specific system, and then it becomes, they start to create this digital culture in and of themselves. So this is really long, and it's from Wikipedia, but I think it's really great. And I'll make these slides available for all of y'all if you want. But users look for guide rails and push interactions, and it happens a lot in social media. So users provide this context and based off what the system allows. The companies can define rules and guide rails, but users provide specific meaning to those rules. So this was my first interaction with social media when I was, I think I was 10. And I pretended to be a 18-year-old boy, and I was on AOL chat rooms a lot. And I always found it really fascinating the way that I could find new chat rooms, the way I could interact with people I'd never met before, but also the way it was so easy to just search for people, that I could just start typing in and like guess at different AIM names, things would pop up or not, but mainly just how I could jump from like chat room to chat room to chat room to chat room, and each of them felt like this self-contained ecosystem. And it was one of the most fascinating things to me that like each ecosystem, while under the greater umbrella of AOL, actually had these incredibly different identities, and I could be whoever I wanted to be, but I could also see what people were talking about, and I could search by topic. So I thought it was fascinating that social media created these new kinds of identities and new kinds of conversations. For the past year, I've been conducting a lot of interviews from people that were using Usenet and AOL from the late 90s to the early aughts, LiveJournal and Echo, to see how social media has evolved, but from the user's perspective. So what did it feel like to be on AOL in the early 90s or the mid 90s? What did it feel like to be on Usenet? What did it feel like to sign up for Echo and to be sent a letter in the mail? So Echo is a New York-based social network made by Stacey Horn. And you can still join today, and you're sent a letter in the mail with instructions on how to sign up. And I think that that's kind of this really fascinating thing of like, this is a specific design choice someone made, and this is the introduction to that community. And those choices, those steps, those barriers, if you will, define what the community is like, and they set the precedent for what the tone is. So I've just been focusing a lot on like, what did it feel like to be online then? What does it feel to be online now? And how is it different? So one of the reasons it's different, and this is something I found really fascinating, how many of you, first of all, were online in the early 90s to late 90s? What about in the like the late 80s? Sort of. So what's fascinating is I was just lecturing the other day to 18-year-olds about AOL. And one of the things I found most fascinating is I had to sort of explain to them how you'd access the internet in the early 90s, and how oftentimes it'd be through a .edu address, a specific place for a terminal, maybe a library. But that when one of my mentors, when she found out Hotmail had been invented, her first reaction was, you can have 1,000 emails now. So it wasn't just this one email that sort of followed you around, allowed you to access to a certain point, and there wasn't just a singular point of which to access the internet. And that's something that's so completely different from now. So like it created this really smaller, more communal, if you will, area, because just the amount of people you were dealing with were so much smaller, and you saw names over and over and over again. And that creates a specific kind of social interaction in that space. While it's digital, while you may not actually know what the actual person looks like, if you can see this sticky persona, this alias that is used over and over again, or this one specific avatar, or a specific style of talking, that creates familiarity in these digital spaces. And it creates new kinds of conversations and ways to interact. So I've been thinking about what our internet is like now. And it's, I made this for my mom. And it's asynchronous. And the internet's always been asynchronous, but it's also board-based. So we have this timeline that exists over this asynchronous internet that creates this false idea as to what language and the way conversation flows. So if I were to post something right now and no one were to like it and just go to the bottom of my Twitter feed and then just disappears, there's this feedback to me as a user that it was never interacted with, and that it's gone, that it's just, it's out of sight, out of mind, and that's disappeared. And that's not true, actually. there's all these different ways to interact with Twitter, like TweetDeck. So perhaps I'm in someone's specific list and 2 days later they'll see it and like it. It's not actually out of mind, but there's not a lot of feedback for users when they post to sort of give that to them, to like let them know that our language is actually data and it can be accessed at different points in different times and it's decontextualized. But the feedback we give users in UI is that our language is very much a timeline. It starts at a certain point and it'll end at a certain point. And that's not really true. Especially with Twitter, conversations can be pulled out of different points, threading often breaks. It's hard to continue this very long conversation in a linear fashion. That's also just not the way the internet is. And that's one of the things I find the most fascinating now. And if you look at Reddit is this board-based communication, and it makes everything feel small and self-contained and very ephemeral, and it's designed to be that way. But it also still feels a bit like a timeline until old content becomes viral and pops back up. And viral is seen as this very unexpected and unusual thing. But if you think about the way the internet is structured, viral is not unusual. The internet, like the system, allows for that, and that's fascinating, but it's not unusual. That's just the way it is. So this is something I like to think about when approaching all different kinds of social media. Facebook, I like donuts. Foursquare, this is where I eat donuts. Instagram, here's a vintage photo of it. But all of these, and while this is a joke, they're actually really, really on point to describing the different needs and wants from different kinds of social networks that facilitate and create different kinds of communities and environments on those networks. And then that, in turn, engenders a specific kind of conversation and a specific kind of community. And this is amazing. So I guess, what does this have to do with consent? And I think a lot. I think this is part of the future of conversation and in essence language. Just moving beyond the way that we shorten words or we create new kinds of verbiage and vocabulary specific and intrinsic to that social network. So V for very, P for pretty, TLDR. You could get into a whole kind of lexicon of vocabulary for 4chan, which in and of itself is fascinating. So all these different platforms are creating new kinds of ways to converse with each other. But what I actually find the most fascinating is the way that language is partitioned, though. So how many people in this room have spoken to a chat robot? Okay. Have you ever figured out a hack to talk to a human at all? At any time when you're on like the telephone? So I often hit 0 over and over and over again. Yeah. But that's a hack, right? So like the system allows for that. Or if you hit enough buttons in anger, you will hear a voice. Hold on. Like, we'll put you in queue for a person. But you figured out that system and you hacked it for your benefit. And the system allows for that. The system could have hung up on you. The system could have put you in another triage. The system could have put you on hold. There's a variety of different things that the system could have done to facilitate or move you away from a human. But it allows for that. The system was designed to allow for that kind of interaction. It's straightforward, but it's flexible. And Twitter is kind of like that, except it's much more flexible. There isn't a lot of user feedback, I would say. The block button could work a lot better in the sense that you can still catch content from other people depending on how intersected in your web they are. So I did this experiment with a person I was dating a while ago. So we had over 200 friends in common, and he had a variety of more followers than I did. But we had an overlap of, 200 friends. And that was a large chunk of who I was following. It was like 75% of who I was following. It was 69% of who he was following. So I blocked him. I told him I was doing this. and then I wanted to see if he could see me in different threads from different people. And he could. And I asked him if I could tweet at him while he was blocked. And he said yes. And he said that he could see my tweets, but he wasn't notified of it in the notification section. But he could see it. He could see replies that he was tagged in as well. The block button feels a lot like this very like a stopgap of like, okay, now you're blocked, I'm not gonna ever see you again. But that's not actually the way it functions. It doesn't actually really stop the majority of a conversation. It just provides a light layer to it, to the user to feel secure in that this other user is blocked, but they're not really. I could even DM the person I was dating. a while ago, like when he was blocked. And that was also one of the weirdest, most fascinating parts. You can't really retweet them, you can't follow them, but if you're linked in a conversation together, you can talk. And that sort of seems like not the way a block button should work at all. And in fact, it seems like muting would just perhaps work better in that instance. So Twitter has this really, really flexible, I would say, infrastructure, if it can allow for something like that. And it's flexible in not a great way, especially when it comes to online harassment. So I focus a lot on Twitter in my research, and a lot of that is a slight bias. It's my social network of choice, but it's also the one I found the easiest to look for different kinds of users, and the layout itself makes sense for searching. Facebook is a lot harder, and we'll actually be getting into Facebook in a second. But I focus a lot on Twitter for my research, and I focus on it mainly because it's a mixed identity space. It's both professional and personal, and it's a mixed emotional space. What that means is like it's used for a variety of different reasons, from networking to actual very intense interpersonal relationships. So last year, I did a deep ethnographic dive into online gaming harassment and Gamergate. And I interviewed over 20 different users, all ranging in different ages, races, gender, and social media reach and usage. I interviewed power users that were developers turned celebrities, and a few users that had few followers and barely tweeted at all. And the one thing I learned is that all of these users have very similar needs that need to be solved in small but radically different ways. Certain users that were power users facing harassment, two of them were game developers that were male. They wanted the ability to interact with anyone that tweeted at them, but they also wanted an ability to be able to filter slightly. Almost all of the women that I interviewed wanted a range of filters or options to change conversation specific points in time depending upon their need at that moment. It wasn't binary. And that to me was fascinating, but it also wasn't very shocking. And what I learned from this is that users need a variety of different they need agency in a platform. They need to be able to have non-binary choices in a platform. So it's not just public or private. It's how can I seem reachable but unreachable? How do I articulate with people that I know but or are friends of friends? And it sort of turned into this large dialogue on like what is safety in Twitter. And one of the things that I have found is this theory that Twitter consents on my behalf. So Twitter leans forward with conversation. It doesn't lean back. There's, I think, a bias in the system itself of wanting to engender communication. And a lot of that is just with the way that the block button is set up, or just promoted tweets, or when you're off your phone and you get a notification that so-and-so is talking about this thing. Twitter is leaning towards creating a very conversational-based area. And that makes sense. It's a social network, right? And it's a social network that is based upon communication. But what would it look like, since it's this mixed identity, mixed emotional space, if users wanted to lean back a little bit? What if the reason to exist on Twitter or social media now is not because you want to communicate, but maybe because there isn't a choice? Think about all the different ways social media affects our lives. And beyond just communication, how many times have you been to a website in the past week that has prompted you to sign in with Facebook or Twitter instead of creating a login? A lot. And that's what I mean by Twitter is not just a conversational tool, even though it's leaning towards that. It's become this passport identity that follows you around in digital spaces. And one of the big things I find about Twitter is going private is a public act. This is a direct user quote. Becoming private in Twitter sets this incredible signal to other users around you. And if it happens in a moment of harassment, it signals to harassers that the victim is turning inward. And it's an incredible, powerful moment, but also an incredibly sad one, depending upon the situation. And it's a power loss, and it's a shift in power dynamics. And it's something that I actually have a huge problem with, primarily because when I think about the affordances we have in real life, we have all these different kinds of affordances. We have semi-private spaces. So for instance, right now, if someone were to shout something, I could choose to answer it or not. I could take my mic off and walk away. I could do a special signal to someone. There was coffee over here that I could throw at them. Not that I would do that, maybe. But the point of that, joking aside, is that there's a lot of affordances in physical spaces. There's a lot of cues that I get as a user. The size of the room, for example, I have a pretty clear indication right now as to who I'm talking to, but I don't have that indication with the live stream. I have no idea who's listening to me. And Twitter, I think about is this borrowed space that we exist in. So Twitter is a cafe where you're allowed to order things. It's not a public park, but it's a cafe where you see 20 people, but there's actually 200 people packed in densely close to you. And so I'm driven by this question as to what does a semi-private space in a public network look like? Like, what if there was a girl's bathroom, so to speak, on Twitter? And the reason I push for that is it's not just a singular use conversational environment anymore. It is a part of this digital identity that exists on the internet, and so is Facebook. So what would it look like if you could set up semi-private spaces outside of DM? What would that look like? What would happen if privacy was talked about as much as mobile usage? And this is what I mean by designing consent. There's a varying levels of consent into conversation. And it's beyond just, do I want to be public or private? So then this has led me to this idea, can design semi harassment? And I think that it can. I really believe that. Through design thinking UI and UX. And I don't mean lean UX. I mean like giving a damn UX. Like looking into real problems of toxicity and seeing how it manifests in social situations, interactions, and figuring out where in the UI can we flip the power dynamic between a power user and a non-power user or a victim of harassment and harassers? And what would that look like? How can we give users affordances and agency in a social network that's decentralized and non-structured but structured? So this is an example of design thinking that I do. I am trying to come up with a new way to describe trolling. So I create a matrix. But a lot of things around this is, how do we design systems that deal with cultural currency? Then how do we start to redefine new words or new behaviors that are coming out of this? So trolling, as like a broad term, works for like a few things related to it, right? Like tweeting at Charmin about your butt when they were doing a social media ad campaign. That would fall into, I would say, like absurdist trolling. But what about casual trolling or dangerous trolling? What are those things? And should harassment fall into trolling? And we start to get into this line of like, what is, again, language? So like saying to someone, I'm going to rape you, that's not necessarily a joke depending upon who's saying it and where. And can it fall into this lexicon of, oh, it's an empty threat because it's in a digital space and it's a one-time thing? Or is it a manifestation of cultural inadequacy and cultural hierarchy? And so how do we start to approach language in a system where language should maybe be agnostic, not Western leaning, and interactions vary from culture to culture, and then we have the top layer of digital culture of the system itself on top of it. So I thought about that for a while. And I decided that the best thing to do would be to change the UI of Twitter. So like Facebook, I am suggesting that there should be a new button. Maybe it's like a privacy button, maybe it's a security checkup. That allows users to start adding privacy filtering. So this is what I would call two steps in. You went from the first page directly to this page. It's not hidden. There aren't multi steps in defining this page. It's a pretty direct user flow. From here, users can start to add filters. So maybe it's allowing followers to tweet at you, sort of based upon this PGP, friends of friends idea. Do not allow accounts less than a certain amount of followers or a certain less than a certain amount of followers to tweet at me. So throughout my ethnographic dive into online harassment, specifically around Gamergate, egg accounts would be created in moments of high intensity harassment. That's a brand new account designed specifically to just harass another person, especially if the original account had already been blocked. So a great way to sort of start filtering that out would be, I don't want an account that has less than 10 followers to even tweet at me. Another example could be having an account that's less than X amount of days, weeks, months old. So if an account was created within like the next hour, I don't want them to tweet at me either. And these filters can be used and turned off and on really quickly in specific moments of a user's timeline and existence in Twitter. So not all experiences are the same. Not all experiences will warrant the same kind of reaction. But what if, depending upon where a user was in their life, they could actually start to filter based off of high intensity, high emotion, or just they wanted to be private for one day. something that Twitter's already sort of started to allow, but I was thinking a lot about what if you could batch block accounts and looking at blocked accounts and then blocked tweets specifically, just around the idea of so if someone were to tweet at you and you would click on the tweet itself, that would be the intent of starting to block, right? That would be the instigation towards a block. What if that was then captured and saved so it could be pulled back up later? I went through this really weird time where Anita Sarkeesian retweeted me, and over the course of 3 days, I had to block over 60 accounts. And I remember thinking, like, I would love to go back and see those tweets that I had originally blocked people from, but there's no way to grab that. And my thought was, what if there was something really dangerous or specific in there that I needed? Not even dangerous, but what if I just really wanted to grab that information again? There's no way to actually grab that. It disappears from my timeline. I have to then go find the person, remember their name, try to like go through their timeline and then do a screenshot. But what if it could just be saved in this area? So then I started looking, and this is more of an example of like all the different tweets. And this could be used for a variety of different means and mechanisms. But what if you could see all of those lined up and then maybe even group by user? This is a mock-up I made around what if you could go through your mentions and start to batch block people. Meaning like if you open Gmail, for example, you can click on the side and start to select things and move. What if the interface then changed and you could group things that way? And you could start grouping things to look at. You could start group like doing mass muting, mass blocking. And all this may seem like small sort of changes, but if you think about in the way in which you live your digital lives, there's so many different ways a variety of users could use these, and that would be tools to facilitate and help and create this the system that they're in and make it much more personal. One of my favorite writers and activists, Sidette Harry, has this great quote where she says, we can tailor suits, why can't we tailor agent, or why can't we tailor networks? And I think that that's beyond fantastic. And I think it's possible, because if Twitter can tell me this much about my analytics from particular tweets and from just my month-to-month being there, it's not that far out of reach to assume or to want or to ask for better filtering options if I can already get all of this metadata about myself. And this is where we're going to get a little bit into Facebook. So how many of you look at the privacy checkup frequently, non-frequently? I look at it all the time, but that, you know, me. So one thing I find fascinating is if you click on privacy checkup and then you go to see who can see your post, there's friends. You can go a little further and see who can contact me. And oftentimes it's like friends of friends. And Facebook, again, leans towards everything being open. So to go through and change things, it doesn't make you private first. It makes everything completely open. How many of y'all have noticed your privacy settings were completely open when maybe a stranger popped up in an interaction, or just someone you realize you weren't friends with were starting to comment? I've had that happen a couple times, and it was fascinating to me that there's this idea that while there is privacy checkup, and I clicked on it, there was no way to sort of show how public or private I was. So I added this layer right here. I don't know if y'all can see it. It looks way different on my screen. So my thought was, what if when you clicked privacy checkup, for maybe the first time, right? Facebook probably have a record of that, or if you've gone through and changed things, or even when they implement a new change in privacy and you click on it, or maybe it's sort of enforced, you have to go through this. It would show you this much of your screen, and then I have a quote here. Great, so your friends can see this, and so can your friend's mom when she comments. And actually start to define with users right here on the homepage, on the front page, as to who can see their posts and when and how they're interacted with. And how would that change user interaction? How would that change the way we view privacy and filtering? And I think that would be something like so beyond fantastic if we could actually start to articulate to users and networks how open and exposed they are, but also how public they are, and actually give a better definition around this is where you sit in an ecosystem. This is who can see you. What if your tweets, instead of saying you had this many impressions, but this many people that were not following you saw this? What would that look like? How would that change the dynamic? One of my big things is I really think we should start to redefine the personas of social media users and actually think about the complexity of the lives we live. What would it look like if we designed Twitter from the perspective of a high school student in Ferguson, or a computer scientist who's a sexual assault survivor? What would that start to look like if we actually began to really think about all the complex lives we live and that we now live them online? So this is, again, one of my favorite quotes. And that's it.
Did I just turn this on or off?
Is it on?
It's on? Okay. So now what we do is we normally open it up to questions.
So that was great. Thank you.
Oh, yeah,
so social media has a default of basically saving everything forever, which
for sure.
has sort of privacy threat. It's also an environmental issue for data centers to be keeping all of this stuff. Is that something you've thought about at all in the design? With Facebook, if you want to delete posts, you have to go through like every, you know, piece by piece. You can't select a chunk of them together. Just wondering what you thought.
Yeah, that is something I think about a lot, just because there is this manual labor in having to in having to individually select things. And that's something that my work is sort of moving more towards now. Like, what if there's an easier way to search your archive and then start to batch select and remove things? And that doesn't exist right now. Like, if you scroll through Facebook in particular, it will start to truncate like last month, last year, et cetera. And there's like little things that get lost in there. It's pulling out highlights. But like, what if there are very specific moments of which you want to remove, or like large swaths? Like, what if you wanted to delete all of January 2012? There isn't really a way to do that. But that is something I've been thinking a lot about, because I've been moving a little away from Twitter and more towards Facebook in my research.
I actually have a question, so
yeah.
I'm going to take the microphone that's in
do
my
it.
Head. So why do you think, as a user researcher, that a lot of these design decisions aren't already built in? Is it having to do with the nature of who is designing, or does it take events like Gamergate to maybe push some of these issues and questions to the people designing systems?
I would say it's a mixture of both. I mean, I think that there's this, this is sometimes like a snarky slide I include, where our systems were designed by white men primarily in a very specific time and place, right? So Twitter was created like what, in 2006? Like, that was a very different internet ecosystem that we existed in. And if you think about Facebook, it started off with just being for schools, and it scaled up allowing non-EDU at a certain point, right? And it started off with specific schools and then more schools and then non-EDU. And I think a lot of that has to do with who's designing and when, but I think it's also this. And I say this having spent a lot of time doing user personas for companies. There's always a lean towards positivity and wanting to think of a positive experience. And I think, this is my own theory, that it's this leaning towards of where are all the positive ways you can use this social network and this platform, and like building it out based from there. But one of the most fundamental classes and things I took away from my master's at the Interactive Telecommunications Program at ITP was I took a design expo class with Clay Shirky, and he was like, great, okay, now whenever you've made something, great, okay, what could possibly go wrong? And you'd have to define all of the ways in which this thing you created could be used in a variety of different ways, starting with like what we would consider the most extreme and then pulling back. And I don't see that happening enough. And I think that when communication tools are created, it's very often an easy and very, I think, a leaning towards Silicon Valley way of thinking that this is revolutionary or this is all the positive attributes, but what are all the negative attributes? And it's hard to think of what the negative attributes are for a system if you only have one group of people making that system. So it's hard to think about the way like a trans high school student would use Facebook and would want a different name if that person's not in the room, or there's not a representative of that group there, or there's not someone that's done research and work for that specific kind of group. Or with Gamergate, one of the reasons I started studying it is I noticed how well Twitter facilitated harassment, and I saw it happening with all these other women around me. So I make video games sometimes, and I have a lot of friends that work in indie games, and so I saw Gamergate sort of start and then just really like kind of explode around us, but in this really specific non-networked but networked way. And one of the things that I thought was the most fascinating is Twitter had this fantastic design for facilitating harassment, and it's because there was almost no stop gaps and there was no filtering. So it was horrible in a fascinating way, though, to just watch the way harassment unfolded. And a lot of that is if you were approaching design thinking about this facilitating and and creating like a necessary conversation, then Twitter is great for that. But what happens when this tool of which you've built this decentralized, non-networked, but networked through your friends list community is susceptible to harassment? Well, there's nothing that stands in your way, right? Like, there's nothing you can do other than going private or creating secondary and tertiary accounts, right? Like alternative accounts.
So I think it's very cool that you've done a redesign of the Twitter UI. And I was wondering, or maybe you've already done this, have you proposed this to Twitter, and what do you think their reaction would be?
If anyone can put me in contact with anyone in engineering at Twitter, that would be fantastic. I have approached a few people that I know through the grapevine that have worked at Twitter or were working there. But yeah, I would love to hear their thoughts. I mean, I really would. Because a lot of what I'm proposing, they have sort of rolled out for verified users. But I really believe that these should be rolled out for everyone. I guess as a designer, my concern lies with non-verified users or non-power users, users that don't have a lot of power on a system, that don't have a lot of places to turn to, and that are very easy to attack. So if you lack a very strong or large grouping to like surround you and help protect you, it makes you like you're an easier victim. And I would love to see these implemented. I would love to just get feedback from them. I spent a lot of time talking to someone that works there, and they were working in branding around ad placement. So I inferred a lot of from him the way that Twitter was structured, just hearing the way that they've placed ads and the way that like they would try to promote things. So I designed these based off of what I'm assuming the infrastructure is, but also just having played around a lot with the Twitter API in the past 3 years.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm wondering if you have thought about how your redesign may affect predictive policing.
So I have thought a lot about that. That's one of the reasons I suggest against IP tracking or using natural language processing, which I'm sure my workplace is like, what? I think that there should be things that are implemented on a user standpoint side, meaning like I think the user should be able to define the way of which others interact with them and the way that they are seen by others, not the opposite way of like a top-down filtering. I'm thinking more of bottom-up. So like IP tracking or filtering out based off of what is learned abusive or harassment-based language through things like natural language processing or natural language classifiers to pull out language. That also leans towards a Western-based audience anyway. English would always be the one leading forward. And I have really thought about this very much from like a language agnostic standpoint and a politically agnostic but politically charged standpoint. So what would I, a user, and I thought of a lot of different standpoints as like an activist or a victim of assault or a victim of online campaigning, would these tools stand up for that? And I worked through a variety of different scenarios, and I think that they do, but I'm super open to feedback around them. But I definitely thought about this as empowering users and marginalized groups, minorities and women, and less like a greater filtering system that benefits the top and then trickles down. I guess it's more grassroots is what I was aiming for.
When thinking about like the user interfaces and making diverse perspective allow for one user interface or the flexibility in that, I guess, do you have any examples of a case where overlaying perspective was used in the process of creating an interface and how that's worked? Or
I actually don't. And that's one thing I think is sort of problematic in the way of which social media is talked about, is there's not a lot of transparency, right? So I have something. I've been working on a project around death and social media. So this idea of like, if social media represents so many different parts of our lives, what happens when users start to die? What happens to their data that's left? What happens to their Facebook page? So I talked to someone from Facebook's memorialization team, and they have thought a lot about death in different cultures, but also like all these phone calls that they would get around, like when someone had been deceased, like what to do, and they were pulling from this call log that they had to start defining that. That's probably the best example that I have. And then they spent a lot of time thinking of all the proper wording, and then what the deceased page would look like if it was memorialized, and how it would be accessible. Death is a completely different, I would say, emotional wheelhouse than like harassment or I would say more active social engagement. The memorialization page becomes effectively inactive from a feed. Users can visit the page, and that's where the activity is housed, but it's never pushed the timeline. But I think that is probably the best example I have in a social network, thinking a lot about different needs from like a cultural standpoint, as well as like a user standpoint, and then implementing change based around that.
Hi, thanks so much.
Yeah, anytime.
I was wondering if you could talk a bit about where you began the talk with some of the structures for AI and chatbots and stuff, and sort of wondering how, in your broad experience, you think current approaches to that kind of AI is embedding some of the bad things that you're
right.
working against, or if it presents like a different way to deal with some of these issues, or basically if you could talk a bit about kind of how you see those things intersecting.
For sure. So I've been thinking a lot about ways in which AI could help mitigate harassment. And it's sort of this really weird specific space. So the way you'd even start to structure AI language is you train an AI through a corpus of data. So like, it's not just feeding an AI documents and being like, great, you can read them, now you can run. It's a series of like beta tests you have to do where you have to go through and ask a variety of different questions and then see the responses that are pulled up and then see if the responses are mapped to the correct responses within that to see if it's returning appropriate language. And a lot of that is like handwritten, like not handwritten, but like answers you've defined. And then the questions are like the new corpus of data that's coming in. The AI is trying to place the answer to these new questions. So it's like, it's this really fascinating sphere to be in, but I also wonder if with harassment, it's like not the right wheelhouse. And I wonder that specifically because I think it's a different emotional space when asking an AI around how do I delete my account versus I'm scared and someone has said something to me. And I sort of feel that like that's not the right place yet for AI, but it is something where I wonder if it could start partitioning out different requests to like different kinds of people, or like figuring out the different flagging that's made. So if it's one thing where it's like this person's being a jerk and I don't like them, like that could maybe be like, oh great, you're just gonna go and fill out this form, versus someone threatened my life and I don't know what to do, then it's like you need to immediately talk to a person. And you can use AI for that, but it is a lot of testing. So it's something where like, let's say on Twitter's end, hypothetically, if they wanted to implement that, they would need to submit the right corpus of data to an AI and then test it over and over again. There's 1,000 ways you can structure like an AI to respond to different kinds of questions with specific answers, and your user's gonna ask in 1,001 ways. And so like that's like, it's a lot of testing to like make sure it's not a broken experience, but also like an appropriate one as well. But I do think it could be used towards, so Twitter implemented WAM, it's Women Action Media, to talk to victims of online harassment. I think that there maybe could have been like a triage towards, all right, this is who's talking to WAM, this is who's talking to an actual Twitter affiliate, and this is who will just fill out a form. And they probably could have structured it that way. And that maybe would have helped provide more actionable solutions, as opposed to just, I was reading, and a lot of my users I interviewed had submitted these reports, and they were told, like, sorry, this isn't actually harassment, when it in fact was. And I think that this probably could have helped with that. But I mean, it's not like a week-long rollout. It's like that would be like a 6 or 8 month endeavor. An endeavor worth doing, mind you, but an endeavor nonetheless.
Thanks for your talk, Caroline.
Anytime.
You have an amazing job.
So I will tell my boss that you said that when I go back to work.
What's interesting to me is you're sort of talking and dealing with technological systems that have been created, as you say, by a sort of Silicon Valley type of culture, but you're also talking about language, which is a deeper system, which sort of harbors its own sort of power dynamics and sort of ethnocentrism within language itself. And you're also talking about sort of designing these tactics for, you know, preventing harassment and such, but you're also coming against sort of a deeper seated cultural system where, you know, those types of, you know, prejudices and biases and discrimination, it's deeply seated in culture. And so we have sort of, humans have this sort of proclivity to hack into systems for both good and bad.
Right.
So even if you were to try to design out, you know, harassment, it could sort of bubble up in some way, shape, or form.
For sure.
So I guess my question is, do you have a sort of theory of change? Like, are you sort of implicitly saying that maybe if you change the design, you could potentially change the culture at large? Or maybe said another way, like, what might be the limits of designing in a system?
So I'm going to reference one of my favorite systems that handles toxicity. It's Riot Games' League of Legends. And League of Legends is a multi-massive online player game. It's an MMO. And they've done amazing work in diminishing toxicity. And a lot of that is if there are, like, reports made against you, you have a lag time of when you can join the game. You carry this score with you where, like, it gets diminished. You can't have as nice articles in the game, things like that. Twitter is not a game, but there are things around Twitter. So does anyone remember the, like, Twitter whale, sorry, you've been tweeting too much right now, or you'd go into Twitter jail? Like, those things could be implemented again. I'm not saying that that's, like, necessarily the right example. Like, let's just, I guess, spitball for a second, you know, ideate. But, like, certain feedback like that to users can actually, again, like, I think dissuade and change, like, slightly behavior within the system. And it's providing direct feedback. So if a user says something like if a user doxes another user and there's no pushback against that, then that's the system telling the user that this is acceptable behavior. And so it's figuring out and it's implementing systems that would say immediately, like, actually, like, you can't even post anyone's address on Twitter, right? So maybe it's, like, recognizing what an address is and then, like, going through and looking internationally the way addresses are structured, right? eBay does this with, like, you can't do anything with an @ and Gmail or a variety of different mails.com. And even if, like, I mean, you could spell it out, there are ways around it, but that's, again, like, a user has to be so dedicated to that. So it's, like, implementing systems like that even. But I think a lot of it is feedback and, like, pushing towards a user. I don't necessarily think that, like, trolling can be completely diminished or removed from systems, but I also think that systems allow for trolling to manifest and to push forward and to escalate into a variety of different spaces, areas, and needs. And so I think if there is system pushback to users, it'll help define, like, this is the way we, the creators of Twitter, have imagined the conversation, because we as the designers and creators want the conversation to be a specific feeling, right? And that can denote a wide variety of different kinds of topics, but it's still specified. And I think that there's this sort of idea that online communication can be anything and everything, and that's not the case. Like, users use, again, to go back to my slide around donuts, right? Users use platforms for different needs and different reasons and different emotional states and for different kinds of interactions. And Twitter, for example, does not have to be all of them. So it can define, like, what is appropriate usage, but also then provide feedback in a system to that. And that's a decision that the company can make and their designers, engineers can make as the designers of Twitter. So as a designer of Watson, there's a specific kind of feedback I think about giving my users because they're also in a very specific place. I do a lot of B2B, right? So, like, what does that look like, business to business versus business to consumer? It's a very specific kind of need. And Twitter can be bold in that statement, be like, this is the way we imagined it going. We're open to a variety of different things, but, like, you just can't post addresses. And would that be horrible, right? Like, what if you could do it over DM? And, like, that, like, lessens the stopgap flow, right? Of, like, people could still be doxxed, but it'd be like a much lesser doxing. It'd be a smaller contained way. And then maybe it'd even be easier to search through DM that way.
Caroline, I'm so grateful that you're thinking about designing into systems user protection and user safety. I think that oftentimes the privacy settings put the onus on the user, that the user is supposed to somehow understand the extent to which their information is being shared. And so that's a question I had for you, is to what extent are you seeing a shift in that there's this tension between the freedom of the user to determine and really the complete lack of knowledge that the user has in how much their information is being shared. And Twitter, for example, I think a lot of us were hiding behind obscurity, right? We just didn't think anyone could find us, and we didn't even think that there could be this aggressive or negative kind of public. And so I was just wondering if you're thinking about...
I've been thinking a lot about that. So for instance, whenever Twitter makes a rollout or an update, they write in a blog post, and then it turns into a press release, and it gets fed out to a variety of different places. And that's, right now, I think their best way to rule these things out. But this may sound strange as a user researcher or a UX designer, but I really believe that these changes need to be rolled out as notifications in the space of Twitter or Facebook or Instagram itself, even though that's a frustrating experience for users. But that actually articulates like what is changing and when, and sort of having users go through and see the way things are changing. I think on my end, what I advocate for is this idea of we sort of need to change like what is accessible or usable in terms of speed. So oftentimes systems are optimizing for speed, including changes that they roll out that change the infrastructure of the system. So like privacy settings is a great example. So what if there was a notification where you had to go through and click things really quickly, even if it's just really quickly to see this is what's changed, and like an agreement that you have to re-sign. So like iTunes does that. Whenever they have an agreement that's changed, you have to go through and re-sign it, and it is annoying. But that's due to they have specific compliance laws around commerce, right? What if that existed in a social media setting? And I think we've leaned too far on speed and optimization for like the way these systems are designed, and not enough actually towards safety. So like I've been looking a lot at banking and compliance laws around fraud as like a metaphor for harassment in social media. So what if when systems when changes were rolled out, a user had to go through and say, like, I'm going to do this and this, and it showed and highlighted the page or example, like, oh, it pulls out a random group of friends, like, this friend can see this, and then their friend who you don't know can see this. Do you like that? And that, while it is more engineering work that has to be done on Facebook's side, for example, it's actually not that much longer of an experience. It's much more illuminating, and it's right there, like, on your desktop or mobile. Like, you can see it when you're on your homepage.
I have another question. Yeah. So I've been thinking a lot about a kind of similar issue, but from the perspective of media manipulation and using how these channels are being used from that perspective. And it's kind of occurred to me that we really don't have a way for like users to mobilize for their own interests on these platforms. They're treated very much like consumers, and yet there's a lot of different kind of issues that used to be considered public or governance issues that are now coming through platforms that we can analogize to public spaces, or we can analogize to a channel or things like that. So as a user researcher, or just as somebody who's interested in this issue, especially as an outsider who's saying like, I have an idea for Twitter, please listen to me.
Right.
How do you suggest users mobilize around these concerns?
I'm almost loath to say it, but a hashtag, like, Gamergate joke. but I would say probably most likely a hashtag. The way I'm going about doing all this is trying to meet as many people as I can and talk as much as I can around these ideas. And then once I hear if someone knows of someone who knows someone, I always ask for an introduction, which may be annoying or probably not the politest way to go about, but I think that's probably the best way. Is this, I think from a general public standpoint, it could be grassroots campaigning via a hashtag, and that may be the best way. Maybe it's going through and publishing something and then trying to generate that. But I think part of the issue is it's like on one hand, to organize, there's like a lack of an organization to organize with, right? Like there's not an infrastructure around like us in this entire room, we could decide on a hashtag right now. But then like it gets scattered and massively decentralized that way, right? Like immediately. So to actually use an example, one of the reasons Gamergate is so fascinating to study is that they have points of, they have places in digital spaces where they organize, where they talk together, and it's not intrinsic to one platform, it's multi-platform. So it's on Reddit, in their specific subreddit, where they talk about a variety of different topics and themes. And the creator of that subreddit is like in charge of the board, and then they can provide other people to like that are appointed, right? So they have this like hierarchy that they don't really acknowledge that is there. And like you can organize with all of these different subboards inside of the subreddit. And like that's where a lot of the organization and the campaigning happens. So if there was something where like, I would say the best way to go about asking for change would be maybe taking that model and starting campaigning around a hashtag and then picking a place to organize. Maybe it's a Slack channel. Maybe there should be public Slack channels, right? Maybe it's an IRC board. Maybe it is like a Facebook group, right? Like it could literally be a public Facebook page where it's like, I created this hashtag. This is what I want. This is what I need. And then appointing people to follow. So, like I would say, like if you look at Duray and Netta, they do a fantastic job of campaigning and organizing frequently, because they've become two people to which are the mouthpieces of specific kinds of movements, right? And so, like if you're looking for information around like protests or Black Lives Matter, like you know the spaces to go to, and you know where to look for information. And like they've been pushing other websites like Stay Woke, right, to help organize around that. So I would say it's like one, hashtag like creation, then two, another place that functions as a bulletin board to provide actionable solutions, and then choosing someone to create those actionable solutions. So maybe it's like I've written a script that I thought about giving in presentations on what to do if you think you're gonna be a victim of swatting, and a way to diminish swatting would be if like everyone in every place I spoke at called their local police department and described what swatting was and said why they were afraid of it. So like that's grassroots knowledge around like this is what swatting is. And so if it becomes more understood and well known, then it's like it's less of a potential prank, right? But that's like a specific kind of organization on like organizational structure on my end, where it's like this is the information you need. This is, I've created a way for you to access it. And then this is then like next week this is what's gonna happen. So it's like that kind. But that can totally work, and we've seen examples of it working positively and negatively.
Hi, yeah. Well, just this piece of this conversation, so it makes me think, I mean, it's an interesting topic. It just makes me think about that maybe we need to remember that these, there are physical spaces attached to these platforms. There are people
right.
who can be contacted, confronted, courted, what have you. And the obvious example, I suppose, is the Real Names campaign with Facebook, where some people actually went to Facebook either headquarters or events where there were Facebook floats and parades and things like that, and confronted them, and then were successful in getting mainstream news media coverage, and so that there were just other avenues. And I think that that's, we can, you know, sometimes not be thinking about that anymore, but I think that actually really works too.
Right.
And in a way, they kind of don't know what to do about that. It's I think it's scary for them, like the real people and stuff. And it's possible to talk to some of these people. So I just want to just mention that, and I don't know what you think about it, but...
I actually am a huge proponent of offline organization, but also even in the sense of providing support for victims of online harassment. So I interviewed a really dear friend of mine who's a rape crisis counselor and has been a victim of online harassment. And I asked her like what her suggestions and solutions were towards this. And she used to live in Massachusetts and different parts of the Northeast. And she was talking about crisis centers for women and how that could be a great point in place to providing feedback, infrastructural design around how to handle like like legislating or creating police reports around online harassment, because there's already people in that center that have been prepped and ready of what to do in different kinds of crisis situations. So for example, getting a caseworker, like you don't have to file things all on yourself. A caseworker can help you. Going to group therapy, figuring out like moving out of an apartment really quickly or trying to stay safe in a safe area. Crisis centers have already figured out how to do that and they do it well. And then I think, again, also like in that vein, I do think you can find people in real life or you can actively protest outside of Facebook or Twitter. And I don't know how many people have done that. It may be easier here because we're all in buildings, we're not in a campus. But I do think that there are offline initiatives people can do. And they actually, I don't think that they get talked about enough. And also could just literally be going up to someone at a conference and being like, here's a pamphlet I wrote about online harassment and safety. Like, please give it a read. And I think people forget about that.
Cool. So I think we'll wrap it up here. I want to thank Caroline very much for coming and speaking with us.